these fearsome jagged rocks actually run out under the sea and have caused several shipwrecks over the centuries, and their deathly nature is very apparent once you know their name. And I will reveal the name of this headland in just a moment.
In today's show, our property shoppers get the measure of our fine selection of houses.
It's a nice size. I just thought it would be larger. This is a nice size room.
What a big kitchen.
But could there be too much of a good thing?
This one is all of this.
All of it?
All of it. And all of this and all of this.
Ooh.
Oh, wow.
Today I'm in North Devon and I'm standing rather precariously on the spine of Mort Point. It was dubbed Mort by the Normans, who used the French word for death to describe the place, and it's said that this is the last place that God made and it'll be the first place the devil takes. Luckily today, for walkers and hikers, it's also part of the Southwest Coast Path, which means that with all these amazing views and fantastic wildlife, far from being deathly, it's all rather life-affirming.
Devon makes up part of England's southwestern peninsula, and bordered by Cornwall, it's where the Bristol Channel extends into the Atlantic. The north of the county is dominated by a glorious, unspoilt stretch of coast, which is characterised by fine sandy beaches, including Westward Ho, which is popular with dog walkers and surfers. Dotted along the coast are pretty fishing villages, such as Clovelly, a settlement of quaint cottages and cobbled streets which cascade down a steep gradient to the sheltered harbour. One of Devon's two national parks, Exmoor, spills over the border from Somerset and occupies the northeastern fringes of the county. The moor's uplands feature heather-clad hills and wooded valleys. Inland, North Devon is largely agricultural, with scatterings of farmsteads and small villages, whilst the few major towns include the estuary settlement of Biddeford, with its attractive quayside. And it's this mix of countryside and coast that makes North Devon such a popular hit with tourists and homeowners alike.
When it comes to property prices, don't be fooled by the headlines for Devon, because although the average price for a detached house here in the county is £347,000, which is £40,000 above the national figure, here in North Devon, figures are much more in line with the national average, so better value for money and also great quality of life. Families are very keen to move around market towns like Colleton or Crediton, and the whole area is a magnet for happy retirees, which is what our buyer today is aspiring to. Let's meet her.
Today's house hunter is IT manager Lorraine from Denham Green near Uxbridge. She's asked her long-term friend Judith along for support and advice.
I met Judith about 42 years ago.
I was lucky enough to be dating her brother. And we're still friends.
And Judith has always been the closest thing I've ever had to a sister.
But Lorraine isn't buying alone. She's married to Paul, and prior commitments mean he can't join the property search. But Judith will be his eyes and ears.
I have a good idea of what Paul would like. I will definitely have an opinion.
Judith has turned some very ordinary properties into absolutely fabulous places. So she's got such an eye that I know she's exactly the right person for me to be taking.
Lorraine has lived in Denham for 10 years, but with retirement approaching, she's looking forward to country life, even though she'll be leaving relations behind.
One of the things that I will obviously miss will be my family, because my brothers live within 3 miles. And obviously my friends that I've grown up with over 60 odd years, but I'm gonna buy a property that has some extra room. So I think I'll probably see them more often than I see them now.
Lorraine has chosen to relocate to North Devon, a place that's close to her heart.
I've spent at least 3 holidays on the coast, and living by the sea or not too far away from the sea has always been part of my dream.
For Judith, who lives in Cornwall, there'll be less of a trek to see her best friend.
At the moment, it takes me a good 5 to 6 hours to drive up to see Lorraine. And if she's down in North Devon, I can do that in about 2 hours, so that would be lovely. We could spend a lot more time together.
Lorraine loves looking after animals and hopes to get more involved once she's moved.
I love horses. When I stop work, I do plan to maybe go and volunteer to help with some of the animal charities.
She also hopes to have the space to keep more animals. It's all part of the rural idyll, which Lorraine and Paul hope to create.
I think Lorraine's life will change for the better. The peace and tranquility and the sea very close by, all the things she's always said she wanted, I think she's going to find, and I think she's going to love it there.
Lorraine and husband Paul would like their home to be within 20 miles of Barnstable, so we'll be looking inland to get them the most for their money. I'm meeting up with Lorraine and friend Jude to run over the property requirements.
So, welcome to North Devon, and thanks for bringing me here. I've never had such a beautiful backdrop for this beginning of the show.
Yes,
we should just
lovely.
Build you a house here.
That would be good.
I don't think I've ever had a house hunt where one half is missing. So, Paul's not here.
No, Paul's not able to come today.
Are you going to be fighting Paul's corner, Jude?
I am indeed. Oh. I am.
Has he given you a brief?
He has.
So tell me what exactly we're looking for. What's the spec of the house?
I think a 3-bedroom minimum, a large kitchen. We both like cooking. Yeah, I like cooking.
Ah, great.
Not too enclosed.
So you're aiming more towards the modern property or something a bit more kind of traditional?
I'm open to both.
Where do you see Lorraine being happy, Jude? Crumbly little cottage with low beams and thatch or something?
No, definitely not that.
No?
No. Sort of halfway between would be nice. Sort of slightly modern, so you've got the good things that come with modern and it's got a little bit of character to it.
And outside is quite important, isn't it?
It is. I love animals and I've always wanted to have lots more animals.
What are we talking?
A pony, a donkey.
Chickens.
Goats.
So how much space outside are you looking for?
Well, I think 1 to 2 acres. That would...
That's quite a lot of land. Do you know how big an acre is?
Yes, I think so. I think your back garden used to be an acre, did it not?
Two.
Or two. OK. Well, that didn't seem too big.
OK. What do you think is a real no-no, Jude?
No swimming pool.
A swimming pool?
No.
You don't like a swimming pool?
I'd love a swimming pool, but my husband
the other
who
half.
Would be doing the maintenance on
I'm
this swimming pool.
The pool.
Right.
No thatched roofs.
No thatch?
No.
And remind us again of your budget. How much have we got to play with?
600,000.
Very good. Well, we've got some beautiful houses, I have to say. North Devon really comes up trumps. Mm-hmm. All we need now is you to fall in love with one of them.
That would be good.
So you kind of keep up your side of the deal?
Definitely.
We should go and see them, shall we?
Yeah.
We'll leave
good.
The lovely seaside and we'll get in the car. Follow
okay.
me.
For £600,000, Lorraine and husband Paul would like a 3-bedroom character property with a large kitchen and a contemporary finish. Outside should deliver 1 to 2 acres of land for the animals. Paul isn't keen on a project, but he would like a workshop. We've lined up an eclectic mix of properties for Lorraine and Paul's envoy, Jude, to weigh up, but they'll have to wait to the end of each tour before I reveal the price. Our mystery house may challenge Lorraine to consider a different way of life to the one she imagines.
So you've had more experience, Jude, of buying down in the West Country. What's your top tip?
Oh, when I was looking for the house we bought, which I love, we just saw it, knew what I could do with it, and your heart just tells you that this is something I'd love to live in, doesn't it, really?
So you feel confident that you can intuit what Paul wants?
I'm fairly sure I will know whether he'd like one of the properties.
Our first house is in the village of King's Nipton, around 16 miles from Barnstable. Kings Nympton is a pretty and popular North Devon village in the middle of a vibrant farming community. It features several stone and thatched cottages, and notable buildings include a 17th century pub and a village hall where a number of clubs and societies meet. Around the back of the Methodist Church is where we find property one.
Here we have it.
It's lovely.
House number one.
It's very pretty, isn't
it? Very pretty. I love it. I love the look of it. Yeah. I like the stone.
Yeah.
It's a Victorian cottage, but it's been completely renovated by the present owner. It's actually been in his family for 50 years. But when you go inside, it's kind of what you were asking for, in a sense. It's like character property on the outside, but all modern, really, on the inside.
So just taking the nice quiet birds. Got a coffee morning going on next door, so a little
but
hum.
But it's still
of,
very quiet.
Yeah. Do you want to have a peep inside?
I'd love a peep inside.
This stone and slate-roofed cottage certainly has the character Lorraine wanted, and I'm confident she'll be equally as impressed by the inside, which has been opened up during recent renovations.
Come on in.
Wow.
Wow, I heard a wow. Wow. Got a subdued wow,
this
but it was a wow.
This is a modern kitchen. Lovely.
Lovely.
Do you see what I mean? They've done a really lovely job.
Yeah.
Yes, they have. It's
making
very
the
nice.
Inside modern, but without stripping out all the... I mean, these are actually new beams, but they're... Lovely oak beams. Oak throughout, actually, lovely oak-fitted cupboards there. Lots of modern fittings, but also enough character, I think, for
these
it to...
These beams are lovely. Sorry. They are lovely.
And what's nice is that you can open these double doors straight out into the garden, so you can have lots of outdoor, indoor kind of living. Jude.
So far, so good.
So far, so good. Mm. Should we continue the tour?
Just off the kitchen, there's a large utility room for all the white goods and access to a workshop, which is in the former garage to the side of the property.
This is the sitting room, similar doors outside onto the garden, and lots of these beautiful wooden fitted features, as well as this, which is interesting. This would have been the bread oven here at the back of the house.
Lovely.
Is this the right sort of scale for you?
I thought it was going to be smaller from the outside, so I'm pleasantly surprised, yes.
So, thumbs up for the downstairs?
Yeah, it's good.
Shall we go see the bedrooms?
Yes.
We can go around this way. This takes us into the back hall.
Upstairs, there's a useful landing area, off which lies a colourful family bathroom, as well as three decent-sized bedrooms, a guest double, a large single, and, of course, the master suite.
This is the biggest room. This is the master, with its own ensuite next door.
That's a fair size.
And you can shut that door so you have it all kind of completely private if you've got guests.
I think it's a very nice size. Again, it's deceptive from outside. I thought it was going to be smaller. Mm. I think it's lovely.
Can't fault it yet.
Minimal work.
Yeah, you wouldn't have to do it. I mean, they've done a beautiful job.
They have.
Of all the finishings. All the doors are oak, all the door furniture is very tasteful. And the bathrooms are really nicely done. Outside is a whole new adventure, so let's slip into the garden.
Lorraine seems impressed by the house, but she also wanted land for animals, as well as outbuildings for husband Paul. There's a large plot here, approaching an acre in size. There's a front lawn and large paved patio area with an orchard to the side. Then, at the back, a sheltered courtyard and larger lawn bordered by mature trees with a pond. Outbuildings include a traditional stone barn to the rear of the courtyard. While the house is completely done, the outside may require a bit of work to accommodate the animals.
What are your thoughts?
I'm not sure. It looks lovely. I'm not sure about the pond.
It's not a swimming pool.
It's not a swimming pool.
It's definitely not a swimming pool.
There are a lot of things you could do with that, though.
Yeah.
You could empty it out for a start if you don't want it as a pond. Because you'd worry about your cats and your...
And the grandchildren.
And the grandchildren. But you could make that into something really quite wonderful.
So what do you think the price of this one is?
I would estimate around £550.
Mm. Jude?
Nearer to the six. £580, £90, something like that.
Well, in this instance, you should listen to Jude, because the price is £595,000.
OK.
It's only been on the market a month, so it's probably a little space for negotiation.
Why don't you have a sniff around the outhouses, because there's quite a few, and also the gardens, and upstairs again, and I'll gather you when it's time to go.
OK. All right, good.
Under budget by £5,000, our first house is a characterful stone cottage, which has been sympathetically restored. There's an open-plan kitchen-diner and three good-sized bedrooms. The plot amounts to an acre with separate garden areas and numerous outbuildings for Lorraine's husband Paul to choose from.
So this is going to be the workshop. His workshop.
Ooh, there's an awful lot of potential in this house altogether, isn't there? Really?
Yeah, I'm not sure about the church.
No. We can't move it.
No. I really love the house. I don't think there's anything that I can change because it doesn't look as if there's anything that's needed to be changed. There isn't as much land as I would like. I'm not sure about the proximity of the church.
My favourite thing about it is the lovely feel it has, and I'm all for that. So I think she should be very happy if she moved into this one. Overall, I think she can see that this would be a lovely place to live.
It's a beautiful sun trap here. A little odd having a church in your front garden, but you're all done?
Yeah, good.
Very good. If you want to pull the door behind you, Jude. We're finished here. We're going to go on to the next house.
Lovely.
Good.
In the north of the county, spanning almost 270 square miles, Exmoor National Park is a breathtaking landscape of rugged moors, woodland and coastline. Once a royal hunting ground, it was granted national park status in the 1950s and is home to its own breed of pony. Exmoor ponies can often be seen roaming freely on the moors. Although hardy, they are endangered. And 10 years ago, a centre was opened here to promote and protect these creatures. Lorraine is keen to look after her own horse when she moves to Devon, so we sent her and Jude to the centre to find out more about these unique semi-wild animals. They're meeting manager Lindsay Green.
Hi there, I'm Lindsay from the Pony Centre.
Lorraine.
I'm Jude.
Hi, so I look after the ponies around here.
Oh, great, what a lovely job. what's unique about the ponies?
Well, the ponies are very special because they've roamed the moors for hundreds of years and they're unique to Exmoor and they're part of the environment here, and it's really important that they help enhance and conserve the landscape.
How do their physical attributes blend in with this terrain?
Oh, well, the ponies are perfectly suited to Exmoor because they're just the right height. They've got good, strong legs so they can run around on rough terrain. They've got a wonderful coat so they can survive in all weathers. And they've got the brains to find the food, find the shelter and look after themselves.
So how many ponies are there on the moor?
There's about 400 free-living ponies on the moor, and that's made up of mostly mares with their foals each year and some stallions with the groups as well.
Although they're free to roam, ponies are actually divided into separate herds, each belonging to different moorland owners. The Pony Centre was set up to take in unwanted foals, which are then reared and placed in suitable homes or released back to the moor to graze. As a charity, the centre relies heavily on volunteers to help with the ponies.
So usually before we groom the ponies, we just like to make sure that we know that they're relaxed and going to be comfortable with us moving around them. So if they look relaxed, like both of these ponies do, we know we're ready to start and give them a good brush. We check them over, make sure they haven't got any injuries or anything that we need to take care of.
The centre can house up to 60 of them at a time. Most go on to leave eventually, but these two are permanent residents, trained as riding ponies for the public.
You must get really attached to them, though.
I do get attached to them, and obviously the ponies that live here with me most of the year round, obviously they're like my family, but the ones that we handle and train and move on, it's wonderful to see them going into new homes.
As well as grooming, volunteers can help exercise them up on the moor. This is a chance for Lorraine to ask Lindsay a few more questions.
So, with my house in the country, how much acreage would I need?
Well, for two equines, you're looking at least a couple of acres. And you'd always want to make sure they had access to water and some shelter.
Yeah. And what about costs then, Lindsay? What would I need?
On an annual basis?
Well, obviously there's yearly worming and farriery, so any type of horse would need its feet checking and then just the feed and any veterinary problems that came up, really.
Lindsay, thank you so much for such a great day.
No, my pleasure. It's been lovely meeting you both. I hope we've given you a good taste of Exmoor.
With horse husbandry tips to take home with her, it's time I took up the reins again and helped find Lorraine a new house. For our second offering, we're heading to the village of High Bickington, 8.5 miles from Barnstable. A pleasant, quite isolated village, High Bickington features characterful thatched properties and narrow lanes. With around 750 residents, local amenities include two pubs, an Anglican church, a Methodist chapel, and a quaint old post office. Property 2 is situated on the edge of the village and is one of four properties centred on a communal courtyard.
Oh, I'm looking forward to showing you this. This is house number 2. All of this.
All of it?
All of it.
Oh, my goodness.
And, more excitingly, all of this and all of the two-acre paddock over there.
Woo! Woo-hoo. Oh, wow.
Don't say we don't deliver.
Gosh.
So, as you can see, it's part of a barn complex. There's four properties. Each of them face their own garden, stretching in different directions. So, even though you have a bit of a community, you're not sort of looking at each other. What do you think about the kind of whole barn conversion idea?
I've looked at a few, but I haven't been inside any. I've looked at them online. Mm-hmm. I'm very curious.
She's speechless.
For once, I can't speak.
That's a good sign. That's a good sign.
It is a good sign.
Let's see if you like the inside.
This 300-year-old barn was converted around 10 years ago when extensions to the original fabric of the building were added. Having taken in the enormous 4-acre setting, we're heading around the back to the main entrance.
Step on in. So if you come over here, you can get the full depth, because these are big rooms. This is the sitting room, the main sitting room.
That's a nice size.
So now you're inside, what are your thoughts?
Okay so far?
Yes, okay so far. It's a lovely size room, yeah, you're right.
Should we go on through into the kitchen?
Yes, please.
The sitting room leads on to a dual aspect dining room, which opens to a lovely, recently fitted kitchen.
This would have been the old wall of the house, so this is the extension, the new part. So much brighter space.
It's smaller than I thought. It's a nice size, mm-hmm. but I thought in comparison to the dining room that this would be larger. Yeah. Maybe I'm missing that island from the other house.
Mm-hmm. Although the kitchen is smaller than Lorraine imagined, there is another option if they wanted to do some work in the future. A utility area connects the kitchen to a vast family room in the modern wing of the barn.
You see, this is quite a room.
Oh, yeah. Lovely size.
Do you see what I mean? That this could make a very lovely kitchen dining room. I mean, a big project, but...
Yeah, it could. Lovely.
Kitchen, yes. Possibility for a bigger lounge, maybe.
There's a host of never-ending options in this property. At the far end of the family room, there's a study, and beyond that, the garage. Upstairs, there are four bedrooms, including a large guest double with ensuite shower, and two decent-sized singles. There's also a family bathroom and the potential master.
This is a nice-sized room.
What do you think about the colour scheme?
I love that wallpaper. And that little bit of colour along with, you know, the other bits that blend in with it, it just brings this room to life, doesn't it?
It's cosy.
Yeah, it is.
It's a big room, but it's a cosy room.
I like that bit of colour in here. Mm.
Now, you mentioned animals. Let's go and see where they would live.
Certainly the house seems to be pleasing the ladies, but now let's turn our attention back to that outside space. Here, Lorraine can't help but be impressed with the land on offer. 4 acres. Comprising a huge entrance driveway, a massive rear lawn with inspiring views of the countryside, a lake, and a paddock. There's even an orchard.
It's quite a plot.
That's quite a plot. That's plenty of space for a donkey and a pony.
For sure.
A few chickens.
Chickens.
Geese.
Yes.
I think this place has maybe got a lot more room than the last house.
And there's plenty of space to expand your menagerie.
Yeah.
It's impressively big outside, which is a little bit daunting, I would have thought.
Well, maybe it doesn't all need to be used.
No, absolutely. I mean, they don't really use that. They just let that go to grass and the farmer comes and tops it once a year. What do you think all this costs?
I think 635.
Mm-hmm. Jude?
I was thinking about 620.
Well, in this case, you're both wrong.
Oh.
Because this is £50 under budget at £599,950.
Under budget.
Wow.
Sold.
Oh, we'd like to hear that.
Gosh.
So, it's in your budget, and it gives you almost double what we offered at the last property. Can't knock that.
No, indeed.
Can you find your way back to the house? Did you leave a trail?
A trail of breadcrumbs, yes.
Go and have an explore. If you can find the front door, I'll be there waiting for you.
OK, lovely, thank you.
A fraction under budget, our second offering is a massive barn conversion with four reception rooms, including a large family room. There are four bedrooms and 4 acres of land to play with. Lorraine clearly loves it, but can she second-guess her husband's thoughts?
I'm trying to think how Paul would see the house. Initially, I think he will find the land a bit daunting. I know the inside of the house, he will love that. He will love the kitchen because it's a lovely modern kitchen. The dining room alongside it's great. Absolutely great. I could easily see us living in.
Oh, I think Paul would love it. But again, it might be that the land would daunt him a little bit because he would probably have to do all the mowing and attending. So we shall see. But I think he'd love the house.
Okie dokie, ladies. I know you love this one, but time to draw a line under today's houses because we've got to get ready for the mystery house tomorrow.
Okay. Good.
I'm in North Devon with Lorraine from Buckinghamshire, who, with the help of her best friend Jude, is hoping her £600,000 will get her a country home with land. Up next, our rather breathtaking mystery house.
Oh, gosh. Oh, wow. I didn't expect that.
No.
No.
That's what I meant. It's a fuller house full of surprises.
It is, isn't it?
And it's full steam ahead as I take a whistle-stop tour across one of Devon's most inspiring landscapes.
We've moved this lever right the way back. Pull this one up gently.
This is the steam going into the
pistons. Yes, you can hear it. And away we go.
Under normal circumstances, I'd say yesterday was a great triumph. Jude and Lorraine seem to love the second house. However, there's something rather strange about the show because the person with the deciding vote, Paul, isn't here, so we don't know whether he might absolutely hate it. The one thing we do know about Paul, however, is that he's not up for any big DIY, knocking down walls or converting barns. So when we turn to the mystery house, this, amongst many other things the mystery house offers, is key. It is definitely a finished, ready to move into project. So all we have to do now is take Jude and Lorraine there and make them fall in love with it first.
For our final house, we're heading towards the Exmoor National Park to the hamlet of West Anstey. The closest place for a range of services is the characterful town of South Moulton. The town's early wealth was built from the wool trade, and in the 18th century, it continued to flourish with the building of the town hall and assembly rooms. Today, it's popular with shoppers and tourists due to its proximity to the national park. Our mystery house is 10 miles away, located in a more remote setting than our previous offerings. It also takes Lorraine further away from Barnstable. However, this is a property with potential, but not in the way she probably imagines.
Right, mystery house time. Okay. So we brought you to the very edge of Exmoor, to, I think, an extraordinary property. Very interesting. Now, the thing about this property is it's got a lot of potential. I don't mean that in the sense there's lots to do. Everything is done. It's in the fact that there's lots of elements. You've got a beautiful farmhouse. It was the farmhouse that all these buildings belonged to. And it's been developed in the last 4 years by these very enterprising present owners who've completely modernised it inside and have allowed this building at the end to function as a completely separate annex.
OK.
So you have your home, and then you have a potential second home for visiting family or another income stream for letting it out.
OK. Mm-hmm.
What are your thoughts about that? You're looking at me very warily.
That sounds like work to me.
Yeah, well, I mean, it doesn't have to be work. You could just have it as a guest space.
OK.
So it is a remote offering, but it's quite an exceptional building, particularly when we get inside. And it has lots of land, probably more manageable land than the one yesterday. Well, let's see if you'd like living in the house. Shall we look?
I don't want Lorraine to be put off by the holiday let idea, as the house could easily be reconfigured into one home, and a pretty stylish one at that.
It's quite a surprise when you get inside.
Oh, gosh. Oh, wow. It is.
What a big kitchen.
It's a big, very modern, very high-end kitchen.
Oh, I didn't expect that.
No.
No.
That's what I meant. It's a full house full of surprises.
It is, isn't it?
This would have been the outside wall of the original cottage. And as you can see, they've completely gutted it, put in these lovely bifold doors so you can open it up all the way.
I think it's a really lovely kitchen. Beautiful size.
This is all the downstairs space. There's a utility room, downstairs toilet through there. But so this is the sitting room. I mean, there was originally a door that went through into that second wing. You could reinstate that if you wanted.
OK.
But they just have this as their living space and have that separate.
That's nice. That space looks good.
There's three bedrooms upstairs in this part of the house and another two next door. So let's look at the ones up here.
OK.
Those upstairs bedrooms in the main house include two good-sized double rooms, which are serviced by a stunning family bathroom with freestanding bath. But I'm showing them the possible master suite.
Come into this bedroom. So it's got an ensuite. It's got built-in wardrobes. They don't actually use it as a master bedroom. There's the one at the other end, which has views. But this is the more obvious master suite. What do you think about the proportions upstairs? Is it enough for you?
I think so. I think they're all very good-sized rooms. Mm. The other two are good-sized rooms.
Yeah. Jude, on the decor?
I love the bathroom. I think that's beautiful.
I like the size of the room. I like the colours.
But then there is this other entity on the other side of this wall, which is a self-contained sort of two-bedroom cottage. So should we have a peek in there?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Whilst the majority of the main house is a modern extension, the annex is located in what would have been the original farm cottage and offers a cosier living space.
Come in. So you immediately get to see the smaller. This is the original cottage, how they would have been, actually, without all the walls taken out. So this is the small sitting room. You've got a kitchen, fully fitted kitchen up there, and then two bedrooms upstairs.
It's cosy. I wasn't particularly looking to partition off part of the house. Mm. So I'm not really interested in rentals. Nothing's ringing my bell at the moment.
Oh, well, they don't all have to ring your bells.
It's a lot to take in, but with easily enough space in the main house, the self-contained annex could give Lorraine and Paul options in the future. But let's focus on the thing that I know she wants, land. There's over an acre here, much of it laid to lawn. At the front, an enclosed paddock leads down to a small river. There's also a detached stone outbuilding for Paul.
See, keeping the best till last. However, all of this has a price tag attached. What do you think is written on the price tag?
Well, it's a large property, and I was torn over, under, but now I'm going to go over with 610.
OK, and Jude?
This one was difficult for me, but I think I'd place it about 600.
See, if I was running a sweepstake, I would always put my money on Jude, because she's spot on again. £600,000 is the asking price.
OK.
Have a look inside the house, and then you can also go down and look at the river.
OK.
Bang on budget, the mystery property is a former farmhouse with a separate self-contained annex. The accommodation has been stylishly fitted out with a stunning open-plan kitchen. There are five bedrooms, and set in over an acre of land, it's a short drive from Exmoor.
Oh, great. Look at this.
That's fancy. That's lovely.
Very, very nice.
I love this.
Oh, lovely tiles.
Lovely, isn't it?
The house itself has got so many nice features. I'm coming into such a large kitchen, and then the living room right alongside. But I don't get the homey feeling that I've had with property one, and indeed with property two.
I think it's a very, very nice house, but it's a little off the beaten track, and I don't really think that Lorraine will want to come this far out in the wilds, really.
All right, ladies, all done?
Yes, thanks.
Did you see the river?
I did.
Nice, huh?
Very impressive.
Mm. OK, so let's draw a line under this one. All the houses, we've seen all the houses. Let's find somewhere to have a cup of tea.
OK.
These days, North Devon's wild coastline is easily accessible by car. But 150 years ago, when the British seaside holiday was in its infancy, navigating the rugged terrain of Exmoor to the coast was a difficult journey. The railways made mass tourism possible, and in 1895, a line was built from Barnstaple to the small seaside town of Linton. It wasn't a financial success, and eventually closed in the 1930s. But today, a section of track has been restored as Heritage Railway. Tony Nicholson from the Linton and Barnstaple Railway Trust is meeting me at Woody Bay Station in the Exmoor National Park to give me a guided tour.
So tell me the history of the line.
1898 it was opened, and it's largely funded by Sir George Newnes of the Newnes Publishers, who was the man who gave the world Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, right, so it was funded by Sherlock Holmes.
You could say that, yes.
Oh, very good.
Woody Bay was the highest point on the line, which is why it's a bit misty this morning.
Oh, okay.
But when the mist clears, you'll be able to see all the way to Wales.
It's an unusual line because I can see it's got narrow gauge.
Yes, it's just 2 foot wide, and the carriages are 6 foot wide, so they're 2 feet either side of the track.
So the 1890 is quite late in railway history.
Yes, it is, yes.
So how long did it run for?
Till 1935, so quite a short life.
Oh, yeah.
So it died young, and like Marilyn Monroe, lived on, you know, as a legend.
When the line closed, they ripped up the track and the locomotives were scrapped. The carriages were sold off for garden sheds. The Trust managed to salvage a few, and today they've been rebuilt. General Manager Martin Budd is in charge of maintaining the reclaimed rolling stock.
This one was actually a summer house in somebody's garden.
Uh-huh.
Yes,
what were the others being used as?
This next one down was on a part of a barn in Barnstaple.
And what are you doing today? What's the
repair? We're just going to change this door handle here for another one because...
Can I give you a hand?
Yes, certainly. If you would like to, it might be loose enough, but...
Finger tight.
No. That's all right.
Got 100 years and I've managed to break it in
that's
like 10
right,
minutes.
We've recovered it. Right, so we'll take that one out and put this one back in, hopefully in the same hole.
Uh-huh.
So if I can give you that
so
one.
So why are we replacing it?
As I say, they're 100 years old, and although we've been through them once, the public can be a bit, generally, they can be a bit heavy-handed with them sometimes, so we tend to...
Yanking them.
Yes.
After getting a handle on the story of the carriages, I'm being rewarded with a ride on one of the restored locomotives. Built in 1915, Axe started her working life on the battlefields of the Somme. She fell into disrepair before the Trust bought her in the 1970s and restored her to her former glory.
OK, Alistair, so before we move, we'll just give a little toot on the whistle.
Oh,
so
yes!
just give a little pull. And then we move this lever right the way back. That's putting it into reverse. Pull this one up a little bit.
A little bit?
Yeah, just pull it up gently. And that's it back there.
So basically, this is the steam going into the pistons.
Yes, you can hear it. And away we go.
Oh, my God, that's amazing.
Just drop it back a tiny little bit.
That's it back there. Oh, it's so romantic.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Leaving Woody Bay Station, the train heads downhill into Exmoor.
Oh, it gets quite steep. It's like a roller coaster.
As I say, the line originally left Barnstaple at sea level, and Woody Bay Station is 1,000 feet above sea level, so in the 16 miles, it climbed 1,000 feet.
In such a timeless landscape, it's easy to imagine the locomotive carrying hordes of Victorian tourists on the way to the seaside.
And you can't smell it at home, but it's got this incredibly evocative smell of oil and the heat is really nice. Presumably it's coke, is it?
Yes, it comes from Wales, what we like to call steam coal.
It's a lovely warmth.
That's right.
Nice fresh air.
Yeah. A mile down the restored line, and we're about to run out of track. Time to take her home.
Right, so now if you move that one into the all the way forward position. There we go, and then that one right the way over this way. Get this one.
And get a bit of a head of steam.
Yeah, and there's a little bit of a delayed reaction between you doing it and it actually happening.
Come on, Axe. Oh, so
there we go, you're driving.
I'm going to give it a whistle. Yeah. Oh, my God, it's so exciting.
Yeah.
80 years after the line was abandoned, it's heartening to see how a committed group of enthusiasts have brought the railway back to life.
So there you go, you're driving a 100-year-old steam engine up the line.
I'm driving a steam engine, and it's very exciting. Woo! Despite its amazing kitchen, it's clear to me that the Mystery House is not going to be a contender for Lorraine. But let's find the two ladies and see what they think about the remaining two houses. Look at you ladies. Oh, cream tea, very good. It feels like a busy week. We've seen lots of big properties. How are you feeling at the end of this week's house hunting?
I am trying to remember some of the good, the pros and the cons on property one and property two. I'm having difficulty balancing the two. Both properties are very, very nice. The church maybe is still a little bit of a question mark for me on property one. Mm. The land on property two might also be a question mark, although that's got possibilities of being able to maybe section some bits of that. But they're both lovely, lovely properties.
Do you think there's any kind of clear water between the two?
The second one for me would be my choice. But knowing Lorraine so well, I think maybe the first one would be less for her to manage.
What happens next, Lorraine? What's the next step for you and Paul?
I certainly want to go back, show him the properties on paper, online. And then, yeah, I'd like to go to show him the properties.
Well, I hope it all goes well. I hope Paul loves one of our houses, obviously. And it's been lovely showing you around North Devon. Should we tuck into these scones?
Good idea.
We did, I think, find Lorraine two really strong and beautiful properties that she liked, that Jude liked. All we need now is husband Paul to like them too. But most of all, I think we focused Lorraine's mind on the excitement and the glory of moving to this fantastic county and starting a new life. And when you look around, who can blame her? So make sure you join us next time for more inspiring tales of rural property shopping here on Escape to the Country.
Ultimately, husband Paul and Lorraine felt that house number two wasn't close enough to a large village and are continuing their property search. If you'd like to escape to the country in England, Scotland, Wales or Northern Ireland and would like our help, why not apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.